Welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be talking about graphing rational functions with minimal to no technology. Let's look at what a rational function is. A rational function is a ratio of two polynomials, frequently called p and q. The standard form of a polynomial is a sum of powers of x with coefficients that are real numbers. This is the form where we can easily see the degree n and the leading coefficient a sub n. The factored form of a polynomial is a product. A times x minus x naught times x minus x sub 1, and so on. This is the form where we can easily see the zeros. For our first example, let's identify the leading coefficient as well as the zeros of the polynomial in the numerator and denominator for the rational function x squared minus 7 over x squared minus 3x plus 2. For our numerator, we have x squared minus 7. This factors as x minus root 7 times x plus root 7. Remember, this is a difference of squares, and that'll help you factor just a little bit quicker. Our denominator is x squared minus 3x plus 2. This factors as x minus 2 times x minus 1. And why did we choose negative 2 and negative 1? Because those add to the middle coefficient, negative 3, and multiply to the positive 2. Now that we have the factored form, we can very easily see the zeros. So the zeros for the numerator would be root 7 and negative root 7. And for the denominator, it would be 2 and 1. To get those, we can set each factor equal to 0 and solve. Let's take a look at the leading coefficients. Looking at the unfactored form would be the easiest. We see the leading term for the numerator is x squared, and the leading coefficient would be 1. For the denominator, the leading term is x squared, and again, the leading coefficient would be 1. Moving on, let's look at what characteristics we're searching for on these graphs. We'll be looking for x and y intercepts, which don't always happen. We'll also be looking for vertical asymptotes, which, make a note, cannot be intersected. We'll be looking for horizontal asymptotes, which may be intersected, and these are going to occur on a case-by-case basis. So the first case is when the degree of the denominator is bigger. At this case, we'll have a horizontal asymptote at y equals 0. In our second case, this will happen when the degrees tie. There will be a horizontal asymptote at y equals the leading coefficient of the numerator over the leading coefficient of the denominator. Another common case, which we won't cover in this video, are slant asymptotes. Slant asymptotes occur when the degree of a numerator is bigger by 1. And lastly, we'll be looking at holes, which some people refer to as removable discontinuities. These happen when there is a factor that completely reduces out. For an example, let's identify the characteristics we need to sketch the rational function f of x equals x minus 1 times x minus 2 in the numerator and the denominator x minus 2 times 4x minus 3. Because this is already factored, we're going to find the holes first. Noticing that there's a repeated factor of x minus 2, that means we have a hole at x equals 2. And to find the y-coordinate, we'll plug in x equals 2 to the reduced function. Our reduced function is f of x equals x minus 1 over 4x minus 3. So plugging in our 2 as our x, we'll get 2 minus 1 over 4 times 2 minus 3, which gives us 1 over 5. So we have our hole at 2 a fifth. Next, we're going to cover how to find the x-intercepts. The x-intercepts will be the zeros of the polynomial in the numerator after you reduce your rational function to the simplest terms. So on our example, the x minus 2s reduce, leaving only the factor x minus 1 in the numerator. Setting that equal to 0 and solving, we see that x equals 1 is our 0, which means we'll have an x-intercept at 1, 0. Next, we're going to find the y-intercepts. The y-intercepts will be the coordinates of the point you get when you plug in x equals 0. On our example, that means 0 minus 1 over 4 times 0 minus 3, which gives us negative 1 over negative 3, which reduces to a third. So our y-intercept is at 0, a third. Next, we're going to be looking at how to find the vertical asymptotes. The vertical asymptotes will be the zeros of the polynomial in the denominator after you reduce your rational function to simplest terms. So in our case, we reduce out the x minus 2. Then we have one factor left of 4x minus 3, which we set equal to 0 and solve. We get that x equals 3/4 is our vertical asymptote. Let's look at how to find the horizontal asymptotes. These will only happen if the degrees of the numerator tie or if the degree of the polynomial in the denominator is bigger. On our example, it's a tie. The degree of the numerator is going to be determined by the largest power on the leading term. In our case, there's nothing to expand. So we have x minus 1 in the numerator, and it has degree 1. In the denominator, we have 4x minus 3, and its degree is also 1. So in this case, our degrees tie, and our horizontal asymptote will be happening at the ratio of the leading coefficients. The leading coefficient of our numerator is 1, and the leading coefficient of our denominator is 4. So we'll have a horizontal asymptote at y equals 1/4. Looking at slant asymptotes, note that these will only happen when the degree of the numerator is larger. So on our example, we're not going to have any slant asymptotes because the degrees tied. In general, you'll notice that you will not have both a slant and a horizontal asymptote. Next, let's determine if our function crosses the horizontal asymptote. This is going to happen if there's a solution to the equation that results when you set your function equal to your horizontal asymptote. On our example, our horizontal asymptote is 1/4, so we'll set our function equal and solve. Using cross multiplication, we get 4x minus 3 equals 4 times x minus 2. We distribute the 4 on the right, so we get 4x minus 3 equals 4x minus 8. Taking away the 4x from each side, we're left with an equation that doesn't make much sense. Negative 3 equals negative 8. That's no solution, so that means we have no intersection of the horizontal asymptote. A common question I get is whether our function will intersect the vertical asymptote. The answer is no, it never will. Reason being, a vertical asymptote is a point where you plug in x equals a particular number and you get division by 0. This division by 0 does not reduce out. We've already got rid of the holes at this point, and so you can't plug in an x value that would result in division by 0. That's why you can't intersect the vertical asymptote. Now we're finally ready to go ahead and start sketching our function. We're going to go ahead and put all of our preliminary information down first, and then we're going to do a t-chart and gather more points strategically that will help us inform our sketch. So let's do it. On the left, we see all of the information that we've already found for this function. We've got the hole, the x-intercepts, the y-intercepts, the vertical asymptotes, and the horizontal asymptote. And remember that we found that we cannot intersect the horizontal asymptote. So as we draw this on the picture, we're going to make sure that we're labeling our scale, we're labeling the asymptotes with their appropriate equation, and we're labeling any points that we sketch. Notice that our x-intercept and y-intercept are solid points, but our hole is not going to be a solid point. Because remember, a hole is a discontinuity. That means that when we plug in that x value to our original function, we get division by 0. So we're going to leave that as an open point and understand that the function is tending towards that point, but will never actually reach it. So we're leaving it open. Now looking at this sketch, we can better choose some x values that would be appropriate. We'll go ahead and choose x values to both the left and right of the asymptote. Let's go ahead and choose x equals negative 1, a point that's a little far away from the asymptote. Then we'll choose x equals 0.749, a point that's really close to our asymptote on the left. And then we'll choose 0.7501, a point that's really close to the right of the asymptote. This way we'll have an idea how this function is behaving on either side of the asymptote and whether it's going to approach positive infinity or negative infinity. Now, depending on your teacher's preferences, you can go ahead and put these into a scientific calculator by plugging in those x values for our function in simplest terms, x minus 1 over 4x minus 3. Or if your teacher allows a graphing calculator such as the TI-84CE, you can go ahead and put your function into the y equals menu and then generate a table using the table menu. And that can a little bit more quickly give you the computation. After doing that, we get that x equals negative 1 has y value 0.2857, 0.749 has y value 62.75, and 0.7501 has y value negative 624.8. So that tells me that to the left of the asymptote, our function's approaching positive infinity, to the right of the asymptote, it's approaching negative infinity. And this is our sketch. Now let's compare our sketch to a picture that technology would generate. When our technology graphs these, they will not do a great job of showing asymptotes. You won't see clear asymptotes drawn. The other thing that the technology is really not great about displaying is it's not going to clearly display holes for you. That doesn't mean that the calculator thinks you can plug something in, it just means that it doesn't display it. So no matter how far you zoom in on a hole, especially on the TI-84, you won't see a hole sketched there. Well, that's all for this video, folks. If you have any interest in slant asymptotes or more advanced rational functions, let me know in the comment section, and I'll see about making a part 2. See you next time.